Today's topic is in continuation of the yesterday's topic, Autocoid 1, where we discussed the histamine and antihistamine drugs. So, taking the topic forward, we will talk about the 5-hydroxytryptamine. As we discussed earlier, in the classical autocoids, we have amine autocoids, lipid-derived autocoids, and peptide autocoids. From the amine autocoids, yesterday we discussed the histamine and antihistamine drugs, and now we are going to discuss the 5-hydroxytryptamine. And later on, in the same class, we will be talking about the lipid-derived autocoids, that is prostaglandin, leukotrienes, platelet activating factor. So, starting with the serotonin, also called 5-hydroxytryptamine or serotonin. So, what is 5-hydroxytryptamine? This is, you can say that this is an autocoid mediator which is without any portfolio, and it is discharging its responsibilities with full freedom, but it has no responsibility. So, 5-hydroxytryptamine has got diverse physiological and pharmacological role. It acts as a neurotransmitter in central nervous system. It is the regulator of cardiac and enteric smooth muscle. It is the regulator of platelet function, and it has got the solidarity role in several functions. So, where are the 5-hydroxytryptamine distributed? So, there are several structures which are rich in the 5-hydroxytryptamine. Amongst them is the gastrointestinal tract enterochromaffin cells, where there is 90% of the 5-hydroxytryptamine is located, and it is present in the myenteric plexus as well, where it serves as the prokinetic agent and neurotransmitter. Then second, it is present in the platelets also, so where it diffuses inside by active transport from plasma and is released at the site of damage after platelet aggregation. 5-hydroxytryptamine is also present in the lungs, bone marrow and pineal glands as a precursor to melatonin, so, and in the CNS as neurotransmitter. So, how is the 5-hydroxytryptamine synthesized? It is formed from the dietary tryptophan by the action of tryptophan hydroxylase, and 5-hydroxytryptophan is produced by the action of tryptophan hydroxylase on the dietary tryptophan, and this 5-hydroxytryptophan, when acted upon by the L-amino acid decarboxylase, will lead to 5-hydroxy formation of the 5-hydroxytryptamine. So, here again there is a sketchy diagram. Tryptophan acted upon by the hydroxylase, 5-hydroxytryptophan, which becomes decarboxylated to 5-hydroxytryptamine. When it gets acted upon by the monoamine oxidase, then it gets converted into 5-HIAA, which is 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid. And when it is acted upon by the dehydrogenase enzyme, it gets converted into 5-hydroxytryptophol. So, where is the 5-hydroxytryptamine stored, how it is released and how it is degraded? So, again, it is stored in the enterochromaffin cells and neurons, as we discussed in the last slide. And it is not stored alone, it is stored as a co-transmitter with many peptide hormones like somatostatin, VIP and substance P. In the last sketchy diagram, we saw how it was degraded. Sudden degradation is by the oxidative deamination, forms the 5-hydroxyindole acetaldehyde. And this is again, after oxidation, converted into 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid, which is excreted in the urine. So, some of the parts of the 5-hydroxytryptamine are reuptaken as well. So, reuptake of the neurotransmitters are there to conserve the resources of the body. So, uptake of the 5-hydroxytryptamine also occurs, and this is from the synapses by specific monoamine transporters, as we have many monoamine transporters. So, for 5-hydroxytryptamine, there is 5-hydroxytryptamine retake transporter, or you can call it, and they are located on the presynaptic neurons. So, there are several different monoamine transporters. As we know, there are dopamine transmitters, there are norepinephrine transmitters, and there are serotonin transporters. transporter. So dopamine transporter will reuptake the dopamine, norepinephrine transporter will reuptake the norepinephrine, and serotonin transporter will take up the serotonin, which is 5-hydroxytryptamine. There are other many agents, drugs, which can inhibit the 5-hydroxytryptamine reuptake, as is with the other reuptake inhibitors. So cocaine, tricyclic antidepressant, and selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors like fluoxetine are the various agents which are able to inhibit the 5-hydroxytryptamine reuptake. The serotonin neurotransmission as it occurs can be modified at the presynaptic synaptic level by inhibiting the three steps, which is you can modify at the degradation level, you can modify at the storage level, or you can modify at the reuptake level. So when at the presynaptic level you are using degradation inhibitor like monoamine oxidase inhibitors, then you can modify the 5-hydroxytryptamine level. It will not get modified and the concentration will increase. So if you are using the storage inhibitor, so what will happen? The storage of 5-hydroxytryptamine will not be there, and it will cause decrease in the level of the 5-hydroxytryptamine. So the drugs here is amphetamine, methylphenidate, and modafinil. You can work with the reuptake inhibitors. Here reuptake inhibitors will again decrease the concentration of the 5-hydroxytryptamine, where SNRIs, SSRIs, and tricyclic antidepressants are used. Now we coming to the receptors of the 5-hydroxytryptamine or serotonin. So there are seven main types of 5-hydroxytryptamine receptors, from 5-hydroxytryptamine 1 to the 5-hydroxytryptamine 7. The 5-hydroxytryptamine 1 and 2 are further divided into 5 groups and 3 groups respectively. In total, there are 14 types of subtypes of 5-hydroxytryptamine present, and these 5-hydroxytryptamine receptors are located on the cell membrane of the nerves. So here is the sketchy diagram of the 5-hydroxytryptamine. A, B, C is not here. D, E, F is also there in 5-hydroxytryptamine. 5-hydroxytryptamine 2A, 2B, 2C. Then 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. So 5-hydroxy, when we talk about the individual receptors, then 5-hydroxytryptamine 1 receptors, they are located mainly in the CNS, and what they do is they function as the inhibitory presynaptic receptors, which is also called as autoreceptor. These receptors belong to the G protein coupled receptors. They are linked to the adenyl cyclase, and their activation will decrease the level of the cyclic AMP. In the 5-hydroxytryptamine 1 receptors, there are 5 subtypes. So we have 5-hydroxytryptamine 1A, 1B, 1D, 1E, and 1F. 1C was found to be closer to the second hydroxytryptamine receptor, so it has been designated as 2C instead of 1C. We will come to the site of the receptors. The receptors, 5-hydroxytryptamine receptors, all of the receptors are present in the CNS. In the cerebral vessels, only the 5-hydroxytryptamine 1D receptors are present. In the nerve endings, the nociceptive 5-hydroxytryptamine 3 receptors are there. In the enteric mucosa, 5-hydroxytryptamine 3 are present. And in the myenteric plexuses, 5-hydroxytryptamine 4 receptors are present. On the smooth muscles, 5-hydroxytryptamine 2A is present. Smooth muscles present in the vessels as well as in the bronchi. So smooth muscles meaning in the blood vessels as well as the bronchi. In the gastric fundus, we have 5-hydroxytryptamine 2B, and in the platelets, we have 5-hydroxytryptamine 2A. 5-hydroxytryptamine 1A is present in the CNS, and what it does neuronal inhibition, acts as of the behavioral effect, it acts as the autoreceptor. The 1B receptor present on the CNS again is the presynaptic inhibitor, acts as autoreceptor. 1D present in the CNS has effect on the behavior, cerebral vasoconstriction, and locomotor. 5-hydroxytryptamine 2A present in the CNS will cause neuronal excitation, and 5-hydroxytryptamine 2C present on the choroid plexus will cause increase or decrease in the CSF secretion. 5-hydroxytryptamine, when present on the CNS, they are causing excitation, anxiety, sensory neuron pain and itching. 5-hydroxytryptamine 3 receptors are also present on the enteric neurons, where they cause, on its stimulation, they cause MSS. 5-hydroxytryptamine 4 receptors are also present on the CNS. They will cause neuronal excitation. When they are present on enteric neurons, they cause GI motility. 5-hydroxytryptamine 5 and 6 are also present on the CNS, and 7 is also present on the CNS, where it has effect on the GIT and blood vessels. Coming to the pharmacological action of the 5-hydroxytryptamine. The pharmacological action of the 5-hydroxytryptamine is mediated through a large number of receptors which have diverse characteristics. As we have seen, we have 14 types of 5-hydroxytryptamine receptors. So, coming to the different systems, effect on the central nervous system, 5-hydroxytryptamine is important neurotransmitter in the CNS. This is involved in the regulation of the mood, behavior, sleep, depression, pain perception, sexual activity, thermoregulation, and in hypothalamic control of the pituitary hormones. 5-hydroxytryptamine also is synthesized in the pineal gland, or it is the precursor to the synthesis of the melatonin and the melatonin stimulating hormone, which influences the sleep-wake cycle. If 5-hydroxytryptamine is injected IV, it does not cross the blood-brain barrier. What is the effect on the cardiovascular system? Since they are present on the vascular smooth muscles, so they will on stimulation directly cause contraction of the vascular smooth muscles, and this includes the intracranial muscles as well. In skeletal muscles and heart, it will cause vasodilatation and bradycardia, but here we must press upon the point that 5-hydroxytryptamine, although it causes vasodilatation and bradycardia or causes constriction of vascular smooth muscles in the cardiac muscles as well, it is not involved in physiological regulation of the blood pressure. So, what happens in the cardiovascular system? When 5-hydroxytryptamine is injected intravenously, it will produce typical triphasic response. There will be early sharp decrease in the heart rate and the blood pressure. This bradycardia is mediated by the vagal outflow to the heart, and this can be blocked by the atropine. And this hypotension, consequence of decrease in the cardiac output, and that results due to the bradycardia. After that, there will be increase in the BP due to the peripheral vasoconstriction, and there will be increase in the cardiac output. And finally, there will be sustained phase of hypotension due to the dilatation of blood vessels of the skeletal muscle. So there is three phase. First, there is decrease in the heart rate and blood pressure, and bradycardia, decrease in the cardiac output, bradycardia, and therefore there will be increase in the BP due to peripheral vasoconstriction. There will be increase in the cardiac output, and there will be third phase will be sustained phase of hypotension due to dilatation of blood vessels of skeletal muscles. Serotonin has effect on the blood platelets also. What it does there is it causes blood platelet aggregation. How it does it? It causes by activating the 5-hydroxytryptamine 2A receptor, and this segregation is followed by the further release of 5-hydroxytryptamine. So, initially 5-hydroxytryptamine will cause blood platelet aggregation by activating its own receptor 5-HT2A, and when this receptor gets stimulated, it will further increase the release of 5-HT. So, it will be a cascading reaction. Whenever there is a damage in the endothelium, the release of 5-hydroxytryptamine from the adherent platelet, what they do is they cause constriction of the area, and they impair the, thereby by constriction they impair the flow of the blood. So platelet derived 5-hydroxytryptamine from this acting on the 5-hydroxy2A receptor has an important role in the vascular disease. Effect on the gastrointestinal tract, 5-HT has got 90% of the presence in the enterochromaffin cells. So what it does there is it stimulates the peristalsis and gastric secretion, and the receptor is 5-hydroxytryptamine 4. this stimulation of 5-HT4 receptor in the enteric nervous system, what it does is it causes increase in the acetylcholine release, and as we, if you remember from the action of acetylcholine on the enteric nervous system is prokinetic, so motility will be increased by the effect of 5-hydroxytryptamine, because 5-hydroxytryptamine receptor stimulation causes increase in the release of the acetylcholine. Also, some 5-HT4 receptor agonists like sisapride and bosapride, they enhance motility. Carcinoid tumor is a tumor of enterochromaffin cells, and it causes, as it is a tumor, it causes, as we said, 90% of the concentration of 5-hydroxytryptamine is in the enterochromaffin cells, and there is tumor of enterochromaffin cells, that means there will be overproduction of 5-hydroxytryptamine, and there will be severe diarrhea because 5-HT4 receptor stimulated increase in the acetylcholine secretion and causes prokinetic activity. In the miscellaneous effect, like histamine, serotonin also stimulates their perception of pain and itch by activating 5-hydroxytryptamine 3 receptors on afferent nerve endings. 5-hydroxytryptamine constricts the bronchial smooth muscles by facilitating acetylcholine release from bronchial vagus nerve endings. There can be hyperventilation due to stimulation of bronchial sensory nerves ending by 5-hydroxytryptamine. And 5-hydroxytryptamine reduces food intake and also has anorexigenic effect. So we must see the agonist and the antagonist at the 5-hydroxytryptamine receptors. For the 5-hydroxytryptamine 1A receptor, agonist is buspirone and antagonist is ergotamine. For 1D, agonist is sumatriptan and antagonist is ergotamine. You remember that 1-HT1 receptor is mostly in the CNS. So, ergotamine, sumatriptan, these are all drugs which are used in the treatment of migraine. We will be taking up the topic of migraine in a separate lecture. 5-hydroxytryptamine 2A agonist is lysergic acid, LSD. Antagonist is ketanserine, ritanserine, sarcoglylate, methysergide, which acts at the 2A, 2C and ciproheptadine. For 5-hydroxytryptamine 3, agonist is alpha-methyl 5-hydroxytryptamine, antagonist is ondansetron, granisetron and dolacetron. The 5-HT agonist antagonist will be taken care of in a separate session which is dealing with the drugs for emesis, because these antagonists, ondansetron, granisetron, dolacetron, are the potent anti-emetic drugs which are taking care of the chemotherapy induced drugs and post-operative vomiting also. So we will be taking up this in detail in the separate session of anti-emetic and emesis. Then you have 5-hydroxytryptamine agonist, which contains sisapride, renzapride and tigasorode. There is another separate group of drug which is called newer atypical antipsychotic. They act varyingly at the 5-hydroxytryptamine 2A and 5-hydroxytryptamine 2C receptors, blocking action, and they also have, in addition of being dopamine receptor antagonists, and these drugs are clozapine, olanzapine and quetiapine. So these are the newer atypical antipsychotics. This topic will also be taken separately when we are talking about the antipsychotic drugs, and there we will discuss the drugs as well as the receptors in detail. So here 5-hydroxytryptamine 2A effect and function is on CNS, anxiety, imagination, learning, perception, and there is contraction, platelet in central somatic muscle, skeletal muscles, there is contraction in the platelets, there is aggregation. Agonist here at 5-HT2A is yohimbine, and antagonist is aripiprazole, clozapine, olanzapine and trazodone. These are all psychotic drugs, so or hypnotic drugs, so they will be taken care of separately. 5-HT2B receptors present at the CNS causes anxiety and GI motility. Agonist is norfenfluramine and antagonist is agomelatine. For 5-hydroxytryptamine 2C, CNS effect is mood on sleep and anxiety, and drug is clozapine and olanzapine. What are the clinical utilities of the 5-hydroxytryptamine receptors? The drugs used in migraine is sumatriptan, metoclopramide, ergotamine, cyproheptadine. As I said, migraine will be taken as a separate topic. In anxiety, you have buspirone, so you have anxiolytic drugs also, which will be taken as a separate topic. Control of vomiting, they are used ondansetron and the likes of the drugs. This is also being taken as emesis and anti-emetic therapy. In gastric stresses, you have sesapride and GERD. This will be taken together with the H2 blockers and management of peptic ulcer diseases. It is used in Raynaud's disease. Drug is ketanserin. In carcinoid tumor, you have methisergide and cyproheptadine. So there are indications that 5-hydroxytryptamine 1A and 5-hydroxytryptamine 4 are acting as agonists as well as the antagonists. So we can call them partial agonists. 5-hydroxytryptamine 2, 5-hydroxytryptamine 3 antagonists, and 5-hydroxytryptamine uptake inhibitors may have a role in the treatment of Alzheimer's disease and amnesia. This is being explored. Serotonin reuptake inhibitors are useful as antidepressant drugs. So, non-selective tricyclic antidepressant or selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, they are used as antidepressant drugs. So, this finishes with the histamine. Coming to the next topic, which is the lipid-derived autocoids, prostaglandin. So, we will be taking a prostaglandin, after that platelet-activating activating factor and leukotriene. So, in autocoid 2, we can say lipid-derived autocoids, prostaglandin, leukotriene, interleukin, platelet-activating factor. And in peptide-derived autocoids, we come across angiotensin and plasmakinin, which is also called as bradykinin or calidin. So, peptide-derived autocoids will be taken care of when we talk about the angiotensin and angiotensin receptor inhibitors. So, we will be focusing on lipid-derived autocoids just now. So, in the prostaglandins are just not one substance. They are a whole family of compounds. So, prostaglandin starts from A, B, C, D, E, and F, and it is formed in most of the tissues. Why it is called prostaglandin? Initially, it was obtained from the prostate, so it is saddled with the misnomer of prostaglandin, although it is not the only place where prostaglandin is found. It is an inflammatory mediator, and it is derived from the membrane phospholipids. So, it is also called as eicosanoids. So, when we talk about eicosanoids, we will be talking about prostaglandins, we will be talking about thromboxanes, we will be talking about leukotrienes, and we will be talking about the platelet activating factor. So, one name, eicosanoids, include prostaglandin, thromboxanes, leukotrienes, and platelet activating factor. So, here how they are formed, membrane phospholipids acted upon by the phospholipase A2 is converted into arachidonic acid. Arachidonic acid, when acted upon by lipoxygenase, converts into leukotriene. And arachidonic acid has two arms. One is the inflammatory response by newly expressed COX-2. And here is the physiological regulation performed by COX-1. So, arachidonic acid has two arms, COX-1 and COX-2. And these two are blocked by the non-selective COX inhibitors, which we call non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. And inflammatory response by newly expressed COX-2 receptors is expressed by prostaglandin E2, I2, thromboxane A2 and other chemical mediators. What happens by these? There is inflammation, there is pain, there is fever. And this can be blocked by COX-2 selective non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. And the physiological regulation performed by COX-1 is done through the prostaglandin E2, I2 and thromboxane A2. Here E2 will cause GI protection, I2 will cause GI protection, platelet function, regulation of blood flow, kidney function. And thromboxane A2 is for the platelet, so it regulates the platelet function, regulation of blood flow. COX-2 also is present in the endothelium, brain, spinal cord, kidney, macula densa, ovaries and uterus. So, when we are talking about eicosanoids. So the eicosanoids are important mediators of inflammation derived from acetonic acid. We have already seen in that graph, in that diagram. And it is also called eicosa tetraenoic acid. It has got 20 carbon atoms containing unsaturated fatty acid. It has 4 double bonds. Eicosa means 20 carbon atoms. Tetraenoic is 4 double bonds. So there is another name other than the eicosanoids. It is called prostanoids. When we talk about prostanoids, it means we are talking about prostaglandin and thromboxane. Here again another sketchy diagram related with that. Membrane phospholipid, phospholipase A2 enzyme, acidinate, cyclooxygenase enzyme, cyclic endoperoxidase, isomerase, then there is prostaglandin, prostacyclin, thromboxane. So prostaglandins are F2-alpha, D2 and E2 and their actions. So eicosanoids are called local hormones. So they are universally distributed autocoids. All tissues can synthesize one or two prostaglandins or leukotriene. They have specific effects on target cells close to the site of action. They are rapidly degraded, not transported to distal sites within the body. Prostanoid receptors, they have 5 classes of natural prostanoids. Prostaglandin D2, E2, F2 alpha, I2 and thromboxane A2. 5 main classes of prostanoid receptors, they are termed as DP, EP, FP, IP and PP respectively. EP receptors further divided into 4 groups, EP1, 2, 3 and 4. All these receptors are G protein coupled receptors and transducer mechanism utilize these inositol triphosphate diacylglycerol or cyclic AMP. So as I showed in the previous slide, this is also the different slide but showing the same thing. What are the pharmacological effects of prostanoids? So prostanoids are prostaglandin and thromboxane A2. So, prostaglandin I2 and thromboxane A2 have wide variety of effect. Where they are acting? They are acting on the vascular, gastrointestinal, reproductive and bronchial smooth muscles. Other targets could be platelets, kidney, endocrine, adipose tissue and CNS. On the cardiovascular system, prostaglandin E2, what it does is it causes vasodilatation in most vascular blood beds. If it is injected IV, prostaglandin E2, it will fall in BP. It has got a weak positive inotropic effect on the heart. So it may cause increase in the cardiac output slightly. It may increase the capillary permeability. Prostaglandin E2 is continuously being produced in the ductus arteriosus during the fetal life and it keeps it patent. Then prostaglandin F2 alpha, this is a potent vasoconstrictor for large arteries and veins. It has got little effect on blood pressure or heart rate or cardiac contractility or cardiac permeability. And it is not a smooth muscle cell mitogen. Prostaglandin I2 is also uniformly vasodilator, more potent hypotensive than prostaglandin E2. If you remember, prostaglandin E2 was causing vasodilatation. Okay, so prostaglandin I2 is also uniformly vasodilator. More potent hypotensive than prostaglandin E2 and this also keeps the patency of ductus arteriosus. So prostaglandin E2 and I2 both are keeping the patency of the ductus arteriosus. Then thromboxane A2 is a consistent vasoconstrictor, smooth muscles mitogen. Only this eicosanoid has this effect of muscle cell mitogen. And testosterone potentiates effects of by upregulating its TP receptor. Then prostaglandin I2. Prostaglandin I2 only we were talking, which is a uniform vasodilator. So prostaglandin I2 has got effect on the platelet as well. What it does there, it effectively inhibits the platelet aggregation is acting and it is consistently doing this effect. Prostaglandin D2 and E1 also have anti-aggregatory action. Thromboxane A2 is again acting on the platelet. It causes potent platelet aggregation. So prostaglandin I2 and A2, they have the opposite action. So they are working together with prostaglandin I2, maintains the integrity of vascular endothelium, prevents the platelet to aggregate and stick to the arteriolar wall. What is the effect on the uterus? prostaglandin E2 and prostaglandin F2, they are both uniformly acting on the uterus to contract the uterus. Which uterus? Pregnant uterus as well as the non-pregnant uterus. Of these, E2 and F2 alpha more potent is the F2 alpha. F2 alpha more potent than prostaglandin E2. At term, prostaglandins in low doses soften the surface and make it more yielding. Prostaglandin may be produced at time of birth, may be involved in the initiation and progression of the labor. It has been seen that in cases of primary dysmenorrhea, there is increase in the endometrial synthesis of prostaglandin E2 and prostaglandin F2 alpha during the menstruation with uterine constriction. This leads to the ischemic pain. In the bronchial muscles, prostaglandins E2 and I2, they cause the relaxation of the bronchial smooth muscles. Prostaglandin F2 alpha and thromboxane A2 also, prostaglandin D2 through TP receptors, they induce contraction of the respiratory muscles. So E2 and I2, they cause the relaxation of the bronchial smooth muscles, and F2 alpha and thromboxane A2, they induce the contraction of the respiratory muscles. In cases of asthma, there is an imbalance between the prostaglandin F2 alpha and thromboxane A2 and the leukotrienes, which are the bronchoconstrictor prostaglandins. The bronchodilators, prostaglandins, prostaglandin E2, I2 and prostaglandin E1. So, imbalance is there. And in case of asthma, the aspirin, what it does is it shifts the arachidonic acid pathway, which is following the COX pathway. This is blocked because of the aspirin, which is an NSAID, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, and it goes to the leukotriene pathway. And leukotriene pathway will produce leukotriene, and leukotriene is bronchoconstrictor. So, there will be spasm and asthma. In the gastrointestinal tract, prostaglandin E2 causes marked decrease in the acid secretion in the stomach. They are gastroprotective. Prostaglandin I2 also decreases acid secretion, but compared to E2, it is less. And these two together, other than decreasing the acid secretion, also cause increase in the mucus production, and they cause increase in the mucosal blood flow. That is, prostaglandin E2 and I2 are anti-ulcerogenic. The ulcerogenic action of the aspirin group of drug is probably due to loss of this cytoprotective effect. In the gastrointestinal tract, prostaglandin E2 and prostaglandin F2 alpha via EP2 receptor and F2 effect, they cause contraction of the longitudinal muscles of the gut to contract. When E2 is affected, it causes increase in the water and electrolyte secretion in the intestine, and there is colic and diarrhea, which is the important side effect. When F2 alpha is stimulated, it opposes the propulsive action of the prostaglandin E2, and it doesn't produce diarrhea. So both these are balancing each other. So prostaglandins, other than this, prostaglandins seem to play an important role in colonic cancer. If one takes regular aspirin, there is a decreased risk of colonic cancer in predisposed people. In the kidney, there is production of prostaglandin by the renal medulla more than the renal cortex. Prostaglandin E2 and prostaglandin I2 have the effect of natriuresis by virtue of causing renal vasodilatation. They inhibit the antidiuretic hormone action to promote water clearance. They facilitate the beta-1 adenoreceptor stimulated renin release. So, all these will cause the natriuresis, and prostaglandin E2 causes decrease in the chloride reabsorption, and thromboxane A2 causes renal vasoconstriction. In male reproductive system, there are 20 times more prostaglandin E1 and E2 than prostaglandin F2 in a fertile semen. Thromboxane A2 and leukotrienes are not found in the semen. Testosterone promotes prostaglandin production. Large doses of aspirin will decrease the prostaglandin content of the seminal fluid. Prostaglandin E1 enhances the penile erection due to its smooth muscle relaxing effect and increases the sperm motility from vagina to uterus. In the central nervous system, there is no clear role of prostaglandin. In the peripheral nerve endings, prostaglandin E2 and PGI2 sensitize pain receptors at different nerve endings to mediate a mediator of pain, which is histamine, 5-hydroxytryptamine and bradykinin at the inflammatory sites and amplify analgesia. In the endocrine system, prostaglandin E2 facilitates release of growth hormone, thyroid stimulating hormone, adrenocorticotropic hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone and prolactin. Prostaglandin E2 and agonists do not have significant effect on release of these hormones. And prostaglandin E2 also has insulin-like effect on the carbohydrate metabolism. In the bone metabolism, PGE2 has some role in osteoporosis of menopause, that it stimulates the bone reabsorption. In the eye, prostaglandin F2 alpha via F2 receptor action and prostaglandin E2 acts by lowering the intraocular pressure. It increases the outflow of the aqueous humor from the anterior chamber via the uveoscleral pathway. In the cancer, prostaglandin E2 is considered to be principal pro-oncogenic prostanoid. This promotes the polyp formation, colonic carcinogenic. Thrombopsin A2 is another pro-carcinogenic mediator. What are the therapeutic uses of prostanoid and their analogs? Prostaglandins are not popular drug in clinical practice because they are limited available, they are unstable, they have short half-life, they cost, they have adverse effects, and you have to give them mostly by the parenteral route. So, but still some of the analogs of prostaglandins are gaining popularity. So, where they are used therapeutically? So, one of the foremost and common use in abortions, prostaglandin E2 and prostaglandin F2 alpha, as well as their analogs, they terminate the pregnancy. How they do it? They induce the cervical ripening in pregnancy, and these drugs are used in the first and the second trimester of abortion. They appear to soften the cervix and before abortion, and they increase the proteoglycan content and changing collagen characteristics. The drugs used are dinoprostone. This is synthetic prostaglandin E2 derivative. There is misoprostol. This is prostaglandin E1 derivative. This can be given by orally, and it is used with mifepristone, which is an anti-progesterone, to induce abortion in the first week of pregnancy. And carboprost. This is a prostaglandin F2 alpha derivative. This is administered by intra-amniotic route for the second trimester abortion. Prostaglandins facilitate the labor as well as the cervical priming and in postpartum hemorrhage. Oral prostaglandin E2 is superior to oral oxytocin analog. It is as effective as IV oxytocin in augmenting the labor and to check postpartum hemorrhage. Dinoprostone is a prostaglandin E2 derivative. Carboprost, F2 alpha derivative. They are successfully used for PPH control when oxytocin or other drugs are not used. In case of healing peptic ulcer, prostaglandin E1 and E2, they have got remarkable cytoprotective effect against peptic ulcer. E1 derivative is misoprostol, E2 derivative is inprostil. Other uses, they prevent platelet aggregation. PGI2 derivative is epoprostenol. PGE1 and PGI2 can be used in small amount for storage of platelets for trans tissue. This can be done for in cases of dengue. Treat pulmonary hypertension, there is prostaglandin I2 preparation, which is epoprostenol, and prostaglandin I2 analog is treprostinil. For patent ductus arteriosus, there is alprostadil, which is prostaglandin E1 analog, and epoprostenol, which is prostaglandin I2 analog. They can be used in the peripheral vascular disease also. Prostaglandin E1 and I2 infusion is used. The drug is Veraprost, and this is stable oral prostaglandin I2 derivative. In glaucoma, latanoprost is being used, which is a prostaglandin F2 alpha derivative, decreases the intraocular pressure. In male impotence, we are using alprostadil, which is prostaglandin E1 derivative. In cases of myocardial infarction, to decrease the size of the infarct, intravenous infusion of prostaglandin is being tried, prostaglandin I2. The drug is iloprost. In bronchial asthma, aerosolous prostaglandin E2 effectively abort the acute attack. What are the side effects of these drugs? When it is used as an abortive agent, it causes vomiting, diarrhea, fever, bronchoconstriction. It can cause hypotension, syncope, dizziness and flushing. And this can occur also related to vasomotor or vasovagal effect of prostaglandins. There can be anaphylactic shock as well as cardiovascular collapse in case of intra-amniotic use. Ductus fragility over prolonged use of use for patent ductus arteriosus. There could be GI discomfort. Diarrhea in cases of peptic ulcer treatment. When using for glaucoma, there can be brown pigmentation of iris, dryness of the eye, blurred vision when used in the. So this finishes with the prostaglandin. Then we come to the platelet activating factor. Platelet activating factor is also phospholipase A2 causes the formation of arachidonic acid and lysoglycerol phosphoryl choline, which is the precursor to the platelet activating factor, which acts on the different cells like lipid mediators of inflammation, allergies in low concentration, etc. So platelet activating factor, most of the time it is generated and released where most of the inflammatory cells are there and they are being stimulated. And they are also from the platelets on stimulation with thrombin. So here is a sketchy diagram. Membrane round acyl platelet activating factor makes arachidonic acid and lyso platelet activating factor. On acetylation by acetyl coenzyme A, it makes platelet activating factor. It gets degraded by acetyl hydroxylase to lyso platelet activating factor. Again, it is recycled. And here, when acted upon by acetyl transferase, acetylation, again, it becomes bound to the membrane as acyl platelet activating factor, and this whole thing is getting recycled. So, acyl platelet activating factor is getting incorporated in the membrane here. So, when maybe it gets degraded to lyso-PF, it again gets here and gets acetylated, becomes PF, and when it gets acetylated by acetyl transferase, hydrolase, it goes to this stage, and by acyl transferase, it goes to becomes membrane bound. What is the pharmacological action of platelet activating factor? It causes vasodilatation, causes increase in the permeability of the vessels. It is chemotactic to eosinophil and neutrophil, that is, it stimulates neutrophils to aggregate and to stick to vascular endothelium and induce degranulation of eosinophils. It causes activation of the leukocytes, activation of aggregation of platelets, release of thromboxane and bronchoconstriction, implicated in inflammation and in bronchial hyperresponsiveness, also in delayed phase of asthma. This is produced by the fetus at the final term, may be involved in progression of liver and most potent ulcerogen. This is also G-protein coupled receptors, exerts its effect by inositol triphosphate diacylglycerol and leading to calcium release. Some of the actions are mediated through prostaglandins, thromboxane A2 and leukotrienes. It can be considered as extracellular messengers, and glucocorticoids if given can inhibit the platelet activating factor synthesis. Now coming to the leukotrienes, leukotrienes signifies why the name leuko? Because it is first found in leukocyte. Trine depicts a container, conjugate trine system of double bonds. Leukotrienes are, as we saw in the ray diagram, that it is produced product of the lipooxygenase pathway. And lipooxygenase is, what is lipooxygenase? It is a soluble enzyme located in the cytosol. Where it is found? It is found in lungs, platelets, mast cells and WBCs. And this is the main enzyme which is involved in the synthesis of leukotriene. Specific receptors and actions of leukotrienes. Receptors of leukotrienes are called leukotriene receptor. They are BLT receptor for LT leukotriene B4, cysteinyl leukotriene receptor for leukotriene C4, D4 and E4. All leukotrienes receptors are G-protein coupled receptors, and they function by inositol triphosphate diacylglycerol transducer mechanism. Where is the pharmacological action? In the blood, as it is platelet activating factor, it has to be related with the blood. So leukotriene B4 will act BLT1 receptor action, potent chemoattractant. Leukotriene B4 is a potent chemoattractant for neutrophil. Cystinyl leukotriene C4 and D4 potent chemoattractant for eosinophil, and C4 and D4 also promote eosinophil adherence, degranulation and oxygen radical formation. In the heart and blood vessels, leukotriene C4 and leukotriene B4, they cause myocardial contractility and coronary blood flow. They are potent chemoattractant for vascular smooth muscle cells, may play a role in myo-intimal proliferation that occurs after vascular injuries such as caused by angioplasty. In the GIT smooth muscles, leukotriene B4 are present. They cause neutrophil chemotaxis that has been associated with inflammatory bowel disease. And colonic mucosa of patients with inflammatory bowel disease contain increased amount of leukotriene B4. In inflammation also, leukotriene B4 is an important mediator. All types of inflammation, and it is found in rheumatoid arthritis, psoriasis and ulcerative colitis. In the bronchial smooth muscles, actions of leukotrienes within pulmonary system is of bronchoconstriction. They increase the permeability, they increase the mucus secretion by the cystinyl leukotriene 1 and cystinyl leukotriene 2 action. The cystinyl leukotrienes, leukotrienes C4, D4 and E4, mainly involved in the causation of the asthma, and this is documented now. More of this will be discussed in the case in the class on bronchial asthma. Leukotriene E4 is less potent than leukotriene C4 and D4, and but it is longer acting. So what are the drugs which are causing inhibition of synthesis and causing receptor antagonism? So xylitol is one drug which causes blockage of the 5-lipoxygenase enzyme inhibition. So if there is inhibition of the 5-lipoxygenase enzyme, then there won't be any formation of the leukotrienes, which is leukotriene C4 or D4 or E4. So it blocks formation of all leukotrienes and it prevents all leukotriene induced responses. It is used as an anti-asthmatic, anti-inflammatory agent, but it has a shorter duration of action and it has got hepatotoxicity at the side effect. Then another group of drug is zafirlucas, montelucas, pranlucas and giralucas. These are all cystinyl leukotriene receptor or LTD4 receptor antagonists. They are blocking the receptors only, so they reduce bronchospasm associated symptoms mediated through leukotrienes. They can be given orally. They are indicated for prophylaxis therapy of asthma, especially in children who comply purely with inhaled therapies. They have got mild side effects like GIT upset, headache. If sudden withdrawal of glucocorticoid is there in patient taking zafirlucas preparation, then Krug-Strauss syndrome, which is the syndrome of eosinophilia and vasculitis, can occur. Montelukast is safer in this regard than zafirlucast. So this is the diagram showing the effect. So membrane phospholipid, here phospholipase blocked by steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, that is steroid. Then acidonic acid, 5-lipoxygenase produces leukotrienes. This is blocked by leukotriene antagonist xylitol. And here it will be receptor antagonist like montelukast, zafirlucast, etc. Cyclooxygenase, this is blocked by the NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. It produces prostaglandins, prostaglandin, thromboxane, etc. This ends the topic today. Thank you.